Okay, so we're up to DNSSEC. We touched on it a little bit before, and this is a bit more details. DNSSEC is a very strange idea. It does not answer most of the security concerns of normal people that want to use the internet, and it's quite complicated, and therefore it has been very slow to roll out because it is very hard to convince any business why they should spend money putting in DNSSEC when it doesn't actually do much for the bottom line. But anyway, the point here is to make sure you can trust who's giving you DNS records. And there were an enormous amount of DNS poisoning attacks where somebody gives you false DNS records and that reroutes your traffic. So it is a laudable goal to actually be sure you're getting the right answer. The only thing DNSSEC gives you is integrity, which is somewhat logical because there's nothing private on the DNS servers, not really. It's mostly public information, so confidentiality is not really a logical goal, but integrity is the goal. So it, like IP version 6, only even more so, DNSSEC is just constantly changing. Many, many revisions have come out. As you see, it started in 97, updated again in 99, updated again in 2003, and on it goes. So it's a moving target, but of course that's true of the whole internet. Then 2004 and 2005 had more updates, and probably more to come. Anyway, the central heart of this is that now when you get something like an A record from a server that says ebay.com is at this IP address, you also get a signature, an RR SIG record, and that is a digital signature. So the records are passed through a hash function like SHA-1, then you sign it with a private key, and you have a published a public key in your DNS record, so everybody can check the signature by comparing the signed record to your public key and to decrypt it, and then comparing the hash value to the hash value of the record, and that's exactly how digital signatures work in HTTPS. So it's, in principle, perfectly fine. The problem is DNSSEC is not able, well, you can argue about this. Okay, the problem is a man-in-the-middle attack. If you have a normal encryption, and I'm trying to connect to an encrypted server, the victim tries to connect to the server, the attacker's in the middle, so they hear the request from the victim, pass it on to the server, server sends an answer, they pass it on to the victim, and because they're in the middle, they can change the encryption key to a different key which the attacker knows, and the server will not know this is happening, and the victim will not know this is happening, and there is no way to protect yourself against this except to have a trusted third party or a trusted secure channel where you can move a secret back and forth. And so you have to trust somebody else. In HTTPS, you trust the certificate authorities that are built into your browser. There's about 100 of them. And ultimately, the only reason you trust them is because they're rich. So this is an American capitalist model. Anybody rich is good, and we should trust them for that reason. And so they're heads of major corporations and such, and the heads of governments, and you trust all them because they're rich and powerful. In DNSSEC, you trust the root of DNS, ultimately, here. That's your trusted third party. And you trust them because there are 8 famous people in the world of security that are entrusted with part of the key. And like I say, it's just another trust model. And both of them are seriously troubling if you really think about it. But the problem is nobody's found any security where you don't have to trust somebody. And who can you really trust when it gets down to the amount of money flowing over the internet and political risks and such? So nobody knows the answer to that question. So there's the hierarchical chain of trust. You will have somebody up here with a public key, like maybe the root of DNS, and it has a private key. Then they have an entity below them, and this entity is trusted because this person says to trust them and signs it with their private key. Anybody can verify the signature of the public key and say, okay, they really told me I can trust this guy. And this guy does it for the one below them, and so down here is somebody who then signs your DNS record and you trust them, because this person told you to trust them, and you trust them because this person told you to trust them. And at the root of the tree, you just trust anything they say absolutely because they are beyond criticism. And that's how it works. There are other people like Maki Marlinspike trying to come up with an alternative system. He had something he invented where you have some kind of a BitTorrent-like collaboration of nodes, and the nodes vote, and only if a certain number of nodes vote to agree do you trust them, to try to make it that there isn't just one absolute authority at the top, your ultimate repository of trust, but there's nothing in current use that doesn't work this way. Everything works, for better or worse, we work this way. So there's a delegation signer record. This is the link. This is the thing that has the hash of the zone's public key. And you can break the key into a zone counting key and a key signing key if you want to have faster performance and you're getting too many requests, but it amounts to the same thing logically. So the delegation signing record is the object which enables a child zone to be signed by the parent zone and say you can trust them because the parent told you to trust them, and the parent, the person who created this signature held the parent's private key, so you can trust that this child has indeed been authorized to do this by the person above them. Now in practice, in HTTPS, which is the older system, this failed spectacularly, and it was really only the criminal hackers that proved it. Originally, there was just VeriSign, and Dan Kaminsky started to talk about this. When he first got an HTTPS certificate, you had to actually drive to their office with an ID card and a business license and have them inspect you and investigate your business to make sure you were really a legitimate business to get a certificate. But what happened is the business became popular, and so they delegated selling, they authorized other people to sell certificates, and those people in turn authorized people below them. When you got about three steps down, they were just sleazy bums with no antivirus in their computer and a flat network and no verification of anything except that your credit card payment passed, and anybody could just get a certificate anytime. And then eventually they got so sleazy a bunch of them got hacked by the Komodo hacker, and the hacker got in and stole all their certificates and private keys and dumped them out and said these guys are idiots, they don't even update their stuff, they don't even segment their network, they don't even put serial numbers on the certificates, so they can't even tell how many were stolen. And you know, that kind of exposed what happens when you just have a cheaper and a cheaper and a cheaper product until the people selling it don't maintain any security standards at all. So there's some limit to this delegation, but it certainly is true that the mathematics is beautiful, and nobody can create that delegation signature without having the private key. The problem is, if they're cheaper and cheaper, then you wonder how hard is it to get that private key. And ultimately, at some level, it does get so sleazy that people hack in. This is another very strange problem. I was thinking about it earlier today, and I must say, I don't get it. If somebody figures this out, I'd like to know. There's this thing called authenticated denial of existence. You do a DNS query to see, is there a server called fred.ccs.edu? I don't know why it can't just say no. But you would like to get an answer of no, and you would like the answer no to be signed from somebody you can trust, so you know to quit looking for fred.ccs.edu. I don't need to look anymore. I found out it's not there. This turns out to be an enormously difficult problem, authenticated denial of existence, because the alternative is you send a request and the packets are lost somewhere, so you get no answer. And that's not the same thing as being sure it's not there. That just means I was unable to find it, so then you have to try again and time out and all that hogwash. So what was actually done with NSEC was they would sort all your domains in alphabetical order, and then you would search for an NSEC record. And the NSEC record would have aexample.com to cexample.com telling you that if there is nothing between A and C alphabetically. Therefore, you can get this record, and now you can exclude the possibility of anything starting with B being in the domain. This does make it possible to do a query and get an answer which will tell you that it doesn't exist. The problem is it exposes all the names in the domain. And for some reason, which again is kind of nuts, people put records in public DNS servers and then they hope people won't find them. This makes about as much sense as putting stuff on Facebook and hoping people won't notice it. But for some reason people do this, and there's a concern that you want to maintain confidentiality for records on a public DNS server. Which also makes kind of no sense, but that's the way it is. So you can do a dig, abcd.us, and you'll find out this NSEC record go up to zero. That proves there is no star.us. And then when you do the next one, you get a czzus going to D. That means there is nothing between czzh and D in the .us. And so that you can step through it. Anybody that uses this NSEC system, you can do a series of queries to step through, and you will find every single domain name because you'll know where all the gaps are. And it will reveal the existing domain names as the starting and ending point of every chain. All right, so that's what made people mad. You can end up with the same kind of result you would have gotten from a zone transfer. You can get a list of all the domains, and that's a problem to some people, although I'm not sure why. One thing that I would probably have voted for would be to just tell people forget about putting secrets on a public DNS server and knock it off. But anyway, so the next thing was NSEC 3. Here you treat the domain names like passwords. You hash them and salt them. You can even put a salt in many rounds of a hash function. So you create this hashed name, which is If you're looking for fred.ccsr.edu, you can calculate the hash for fred.ccsr.edu and do a query, and then it will say there's no hash between this hash value and that hash value. So you can again prove that there is no Fred, but you have not done anything simple, like proving that some alphabetic range is missing. Only if you did some ridiculous calculation to calculate all the hashes of all possible domain names would you ever be able to figure out what other domain names are excluded by that answer. So that's the plan, and this thing exists. So that's the game here, and it now has a hash algorithm identifier, a number of hashing iterations, salt to seed the hash. So if you make appropriate choices there, you can make this as secure as a password. And it does no longer make it possible to enumerate the domain. So here's an example of this. I think I found, cia.mil uses NSEC3. So I did it for them. If I do a dig for a.b.cia.mil, I get an NSEC3 record here telling me that this hash, UN and all this stuff, and UQ and all that, there is no hash between UN and UQ. So anything starting UP is out. So if the hash of the thing I wanted to find is UP, I've now answered the question. And that's how you go. All right, this does seem very complicated to solve a very small problem to me, but that's the way it is. And so there are no clients of any type that I know of would actually validate any of this. There is if you go to the developer version of Chrome about a year ago, there was an option to get a special beta version of Chrome that would actually check DNSSEC at your client. And I mentioned before, there's a browser extension you can put in that will just tell you if DNSSEC is matching for your record. But mostly it's to protect servers, and you can make a validating resolver. That's the last project. Make a server yourself that actually validates with DNSSEC the information it holds. I'll go through that a little bit later. But anyway, now you can talk about weaknesses. This is probably the most important thing that's wrong with DNSSEC. It doesn't solve the actual primary problem that worries people, which is every time you go to any internet site, your browsing is just broadcast through the local area network, and up to your ISP, you do these unencrypted queries telling everybody every domain you go to, which is a serious invasion of privacy. And DNSSEC does nothing. All DNSSEC does is protect data from the start of authority to the DNS resolver. It doesn't protect the user at all. Not directly, not their privacy. What it does is it decreases the chance that the resolver is going to tell them a lie. But it doesn't even stop anybody in the middle between the user and the DNS resolver from telling them a lie, because they're not verifying the DNS signature at the browser. So, you could argue how much good it doesn't. Another serious problem is glue records. Glue records are kind of insane, and I didn't learn about them until I taught IP version 6. But the point here is, if you're start of authority is a server at ccsf.edu, and you're for the ccsf.edu domain, then nobody who has never made any connection to ccsf.edu at all can ever find you, because they'll not know where you are. They will try to contact your start of authority, but your start of authority is in your domain, so they got a chicken and the egg problem. They can't find your start of authority until they found your domain, and they can't find your domain until they find the start of authority. So the original way to avoid this, which was the official recommendation of best practices of DNS, is everybody should have two name servers, and one of them should be in a different domain. So it should be somewhere else, like sfsu.edu, and you can ask them where CCSF is. But almost nobody does that. In practice, everybody makes their domain servers in their domain, so they put a hardwired glued record of the IP version 4 address of your SOA in the root of DNS, up at .edu or .com. And every time you buy a new domain, they put another record up there, and those are called glue records. And without them, nobody could find any internet connect, any websites. So the glue records are up there. They're owned by the child zone, like ccsf.edu, but they appear in the parent zone, like edu. And they are therefore not authoritative, not protected by DNSSEC. It is because they mix up the levels, they follow up this logical structure of trust, going step by step down to the bottom. This kind of thing happens a lot. You make some beautiful mathematical system, and there is something that goes backwards or the wrong way that can't be protected by it. And there are bigger problems. Here's a really big one. Suppose you have to change your key. This happens. Keys expire. Sometimes keys are compromised. Sometimes companies merge or something. If that happens, there's no way to tell people that your key is no longer valid. In HTTPS, there is a very flawed system of marking certificates as invalid, called a certificate revocation list, and there are more modern versions of it, none of which work very well at all. But in DNSSEC, there is no way at all to do this. This is by design, because there is no way to push any information through DNS. The entire thing is a pull process. If you have anything, if we open up a new server, fred.cc.edu, there is no way to tell the world it's there at all. You just put it in our list of servers and nobody will know until they know to ask for it. You have to advertise it some other way, skywriting or pay for ads on the news or something, so people ask for it. But if some new server appears, your computer doesn't find out about it at all, not until you ask for it. So there is no way to inform you, even of important things, like my key has been stolen and criminals are using it, my DNSSEC register is now signed by an alien entity. There's no way to tell that to anybody. So that's a problem. All right. And there's NSEC 3 records. If you can forge NSEC 3 records, you can then block resolution of a domain by telling people it doesn't exist when it does, or delegating it to another server, and then you can impersonate people and get in. But that happens if the zone is insecurely delegated to another zone, which is a problem that should vanish when DNSSEC is fully deployed, but in the next few decades, when it's only partly deployed, that will happen, where zones are delegated back and forth without the proper signatures on them. If you move to another hosting provider, which happens all the time, then your IP address changes. There's no way to push that out either. And remember, things are cached for about a day, so the old IP address can be used until the signatures expire. There's no way to tell people that I moved to a different host and your cached records are out of date. All right. You can still do zone walking in principle, although this would depend on the quality of your hashing function. I know I've done plenty of password cracking, and it seems to me like you can pretty easily have enough iterations. However, the problem is these things are set up and then they stay up there for a long period of time. So if you chose something very insecure, like one round of SHA-3 with no salt, or SHA-1 with no salt, then in fact people can crack enough hashes to actually do the zone walking again. But it is an issue. Now you've got the authenticated data flag. You did this. If you have verification, your flag comes down and says you can trust this data because it's been authenticated. The problem is the AD flag, the packet is not encrypted. So a man in the middle can just change the AD flag. This is kind of nuts, but that's the way it is. And DNSSEC does not protect the header with the AD flag. So there just seem to be quite a few parts of this thing that are only half-baked. All right. The other thing, of course, is the one I mentioned before. DNSSEC means all your records come with these long cryptographic signatures, so the total amount of bytes being sent is a lot more, so people can multiply their attacks. So this is happening like crazy, using DNS to magnify denial of service attacks, which are ridiculously common now. And of course, verifying the signature means that your server and all the intermediate servers and the clients, if they're validating it, are all doing a whole bunch more CPU cycles, doing all this cryptography on everything that comes in. So it's going to offer, slow things down, and it's going to offer another denial of service attack where the smaller number of packets per second are going to be required to use up all the CPU on the server since it has to do a bunch more extra math on each record that comes in. All right. And so the thing that actually needs to be added to DNSSEC to address some of these problems is DNS curve. And you've also done this in the projects if you're doing the extra data projects. So DNS curve is what protects the end user's privacy. This works at layer 2 using elliptic curve cryptography, and now it sends requests and responses encrypted in their entirety to the resolver. So your data is going to be encrypted to the resolver. After that, it's going to move unencrypted up through the network, so it doesn't protect you all the way end to end the way HTTPS would, but it does protect you on your local network, which is usually the riskiest point where you're in like an airport or a coffee house and the people near you can see it. And up at the top, DNSSEC may be used at your resolver to verify the accuracy of the data, but there's no encryption to make it confidential. However, if you made it to your resolver, the traffic from your resolver to the higher level server is the aggregate traffic of many people using the same resolver. So in a way, privacy is not that much of a concern there. All they're going to know is somebody at your company went to that site. They're not going to know which one of you went to that site. Anyway, that's the game here. So they use elliptic curve cryptography to make it much faster, which is what the NSA told us all to do starting about 8 years ago until 1 year ago when they suddenly freaked out and told us to quit doing it. But as of about 1 year ago, this was regarded as the most efficient and safe way to do cryptography. So DNS curve is not yet a standard, like I said, not end-to-end security. It only protects you from you to your resolver, but that's where most of the risk is. The name server names need to be longer. They have to include this base32 encoding. By the way, you've heard of base64 and hex. There's something in the middle of base32, just to give you a headache. And if you use Bitcoin, there's base58, so you know there's plenty of ways to get you confused. But anyway, there's a long public key. Again, the queries can be large and the responses can be large. Not the queries, but the responses are large, so they might have to use extended DNS or something if they get larger than 255 bytes. And if, of course, if you have a key compromise, you now have to rename the server because the server's name is part of it. The server name has a base32 key in the server's name. So that's the consequences of that. And I just want to, before I do these iClickers, I just want to say something about these projects, because one of them I just had to update, and I know people have done a lot of them. So let me just, one thing is, a lot of people have already gotten an A. People of green already have an A, so everybody should know where they're going and how to get there. And the projects, there's a few things to mention. One is this one here, 6X. I think I'll just mention 6X and 7X. Yeah. So 6X, this one here gave me a lot of problems. Oh, that's fun. Okay. Neat. Just a moment. I wonder if I can fix that. Because people were unable to do this project, and I flattered myself to think I'd fixed it. And there it is. Looks to me like I just forgot to set it up, which is what I thought would happen, so I can do it now on this nice fast network. All right. And you may want to do it. So let me see if it's up there now. There we go. All right. This one here, I had it up a while ago, but the problem is you're using these free domain names. Now, if you're willing to spend $2 and buy a real domain name, your problems will go away. But if you're too cheap to do that, I was using this very sleazy place, .tk, that gives you free domain names. And they weren't responding at all. For the whole of last week, none of their stuff updated at all. And suddenly, about 12 hours ago, they finally finished whatever they're doing and started working again. So now you can do this project. You get a domain name from these guys, ending in .tk, and then give it a website, give it an IP address. I just give you one you can give it, which will point to a page that exists. And then get it to propagate your A record. So this is just ordinary DNS, where you have a domain name and an IP address, and that servers are distributing across the world, slowly propagating out. This took 5 days to update when I did it, and this morning it took like 1 minute, because they finally fixed their junk. It seems like they were down for about a week. Then you go to find your startup authority servers, and you'll find there's something called freenom.com. That's whatever, I think what they did is they sold out to Freenom or something. That's what caused the outage. If that's who they are, that's the default DNS servers. So now I want you to put it behind Cloudflare. You just go to Cloudflare and create an account. And what Cloudflare will tell you is to change your name servers to point to Cloudflare. They have to be your authoritative name server. So you have to go back and change your Freenom name servers to what Cloudflare told you to put there. A couple of Cloudflare things and get rid of the last two. And now, instead of going to Freenom to find your website, they will go to Cloudflare to find your website. But Freenom is still your domain registrar, which just sold you the name and put the name in existence in DNS and put a glue record up top, pointing to your authoritative name server. And so now, if you go look at your A records, they've already changed. You can tell they've changed, and this happened in just seconds this morning, because now you have two A records instead of just one. Because Cloudflare automatically does, it gives you two IP addresses. That's just how they like to do it, so there's two ways in. And if you go to the startup authority, your startup authority is now Cloudflare instead of Freenom, and that means attacks won't hurt your website anymore because Cloudflare will block them on the way to your website. It also means your website will load faster because Cloudflare has local reverse proxies all over the world, so people don't have to go any large distance to get to your server. And it's pretty easy when your domain name registrar actually does their job and updates your authority servers, but they weren't doing that for about a week, which was frustrating students that were getting stuck at various stages of this project. And the last one here is to get a DNSSEC resolving server. So if you just have a DNS server like DIG running, like bind running, you can look up Yahoo and you'll get an answer, but it's not going to be authoritative and it's not going to be verified. So to fix this, you have to do a get a key, and you have to add this to, you have the name.conf, and you have to add a managed key to the bottom of it. And when you're done, you can actually restart bind, and now you'll have an authenticated revolution that says AD, authenticated data. The problem, as we just mentioned, is that that AD itself is not protected by any kind of cryptography. So someone can intercept this in the middle and forge it. But When that isn't happening, you're actually getting a DNSSEC verified answer for where the IETF is. And that's the game there. Anyway, so let me do these iClickers, and then I'll go up to the lab and help anybody who wants help up there. So let's see if this thing is gonna work or what. Looks like it is. And there. All right, so. All right, which one of these makes it trivial to find all the servers in a domain? Now I'm just trying to make this big. There. All right, I'll quit at 35. All right, and that's NSEC, the old system. We're just giving an alphabetical listing of server to server, so with one query per server, you can enumerate them all. All right. What does DNS curve fix? I'll quit at 30. All right, that protects your privacy to some extent. Nothing else. Now, because now the end user's DNS requests are encrypted. That's all it does. However, that's probably the most important thing most end users would care about. All right. What issue does DNSSEC fix? Quit at 30. All right, the only thing it fixes is cache poisoning, the Kaminsky attack. All the rest of those things remain problems. It doesn't give the end users any integrity at all because your browser doesn't verify the signature. And in practice, almost none of the domains you're using are signed. So even if your browser did verify the signature, it wouldn't be able to protect you. The only thing it does is it prevents someone from poisoning the server with DNSSEC. If it's fully deployed and enforced in the browser, it may eventually give the end users integrity of DNS records, but not anytime soon. Which issue is made worse by DNS? And that's packet amplification. This is why Matthew Prince at Cloudflare made a public statement that it was a terrible thing and DNSSEC should not be employed for this reason because it makes DOS attacks worse, which was his major concern. But then about a year later, Cloudflare now offers free DNSSEC to people, which I thought they would. Somebody in his company managed to convince him that it's worth it, even though it's more expensive in terms of packet size. But anyway, that's the problem. Denial of service attacks get even more powerful because of DNSSEC. Anyway, I'll issue one, and I'll stop the recording because that's not particularly public information. This is 40, chapter 6. All right.